Just to check, Neil, everything fine?
It's all good, you can start.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Yesterday, you all had a nice session, and we continue to present you with cloud security deep dive topic. And in the beginning, I would like to thank GE for sponsoring. GE is our annual sponsor. And last time we have done next-gen technologies and artificial intelligence, and then 5G, and we have conducted a webinar successfully. And this time, yesterday we completed one session with one day with the cloud security deep dive sessions. And today we are continuing with that. And once again, I thank GE and all the GE members who are participating and all those who are on the behind support. And really, it is wonderful that GE has given us an opportunity to drive this. And yesterday's Joji's speak was it was very good keynote, and he set the tone for the things to come. Coming to housekeeping rules. All members, you may be knowing me. My name is Chandrasekaran. I am presently Director of Communications for the IST Bangalore chapter. So you can visit our website iac2-bangalore-chapter.org for any current happenings. And you can also visit the site events.iac2-bangalore-chapter.org for the current event and details of any event details. You can check there for registration, everything you can check there. So those who join from IAC2, for every 1 hour of their presence, automatically one CPE will get credited within 5 to 10 days. And those others who want to get the CPE, please write to us at info@iac2-bangalore-chapter.org. And we would like to keep all the sessions very interactive. And please keep the questions coming from the questions link. And then we'll try to address it at the end of the session of the speaker, or at the end of during the panel discussion. And once again, please visit our iac2-bangalore-chapter.org for any current details you would like to know or current knowledge postings. For everything, please visit our website. Okay, let me come to today's agenda. Today we'll be starting with Srikanth Iyer, who is a lead architect with Hybrid Cloud Transformation Services, currently with IBM, and he'll be presenting on hybrid cloud security at around 5:40-5:45. The next speaker will be Anand Prakash. He is a founder for the PingSafe artificial intelligence and AppSecure security, and he is going to talk about attacking the attackers. And finally, we have what's from 6:20 starting till 7 o'clock. We have our panel discussion, and we have good speakers lined up, and they are very good in their field. And I will be introducing the panel members during the time of starting of the panel discussion. But right now, I'm saying that this is Ravindra Kumar. He is a security architect at Google, and Mr. Benny Joseph from product security leader at GE Healthcare, and Anand Tapikar. He's a director of cybersecurity, GE Healthcare. And our Krishna Pandey, he's president of IAC2 Bangalore chapter. He'll be moderating the end of the panel discussion, and he is senior manager security engineering, Citrix. Okay, let me start with the first speaker intro. I welcome all the members and all the GE members for this day two of web session. Webinar session. Mr. Srikanth Iyer is a lead architect with IBM Cloud Transformation Services architecture practice in India. He works on helping clients with the journey to cloud and digital transformation, focusing on complex integration and application modernization, ensuring security is integrated into every layer of the journey to hybrid cloud. He is a thought leader, over 26 years of experience making strategic technology solutions and building solid software engineering teams. He is also an IBM master inventor with 60 patents and architected unique security capabilities for the IBM cloud. Shrikant, over to you, Shrikant.
Thank you, Chandra. Thank you, IAC for the IAC2 for the opportunity to present here the perspective of how do you address hybrid cloud security. So let me start by sharing my screen. Give me one second. Please let me know once the screen is visible.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Thank you. Without much ado, getting started on the topic. So before I get to, how do we address cloud security? What are the key facets and key underpinning tenets for cloud security? I just wanted to give a brief about what we are seeing with clients, with customers, with enterprises transforming to the digital era, and how cloud is such a critical part, and how hybrid multi-cloud is such a critical part of this transformation. So what I've done is to abstract multiple of these engagements that some of the insights is also coming from the company that I represent, from IBM's experience around multiple transformations and helping the clients that that are moving to cloud. So to set the context, so essentially what you see is like there are two sets of things that are happening, and this is across multiple industries, whether we take a banking domain, whether we take telco or retail or consumer products or healthcare. What enterprises are trying to do is to create basically these business platforms, and these business platforms essentially are trying to provide different or differentiating user experience. So these user experience, when we look at these target users, they could be the end customers, they could be their own employees, they could be the suppliers, the partners. So anybody that is interested in that domain, and the lines between where the enterprise ends and where the the partnership or the competition begins are getting thinner. So you look at platforms like Uber or Ola or any of these business platforms as well, as you see it in banking or healthcare. These are actually trying to enable two things. One, there is a lot of new technology out there in the landscape, and there is like a inside out outcomes or possibilities that are driving these changes to digital purposes. And then second, the outside in, I already talked about, there is a lot of changing client expectations, and people are looking for many, many personalized delivery of those expectations. So what is happening is these technologies are coming together, and these use cases or the business use cases are coming together, and there are changes happening in all three dimensions, from an infrastructure standpoint, from an application standpoint, and from a data standpoint. So I'll quickly get into details of what each of these changes that are happening. And then, as you know, a lot of the large enterprises are not starting from scratch. So obviously, even if there is some new solution that has been rolled out like last month, that is also legacy because there are newer stuff out there, and we want to get some of these applications and some of these capabilities to the latest version and latest capabilities, etc. So what we have is a situation when you look at application landscape, there are meet the objectives of this digital push from coming from the line of businesses, from the overall businesses, the existing core and the existing portfolio of applications are under pressure to transform. And obviously, when we are talking about providing personalized stuff and applications that has to scale from 50 to 500 to 5,000 to 50,000 or 500 million users, the scale that we are looking at, this cannot be supported on a traditional environment. So there is a situation where we can't like overnight switch from the my existing apps to the new functions. And there are totally new functions that are getting implemented, like the brown ones that you see here. But then they also have to talk to the existing applications to wire that experience and build that business processes. So essentially, there is a coexistence and interoperability requirement, and that we see coming across all of the clients, going through this transformation to hybrid multi-cloud. So I'm not going to go into a lot of details around why you need hybrid multi-cloud, but if you talk to any of these large enterprises, basically none of them are relying on one provider, whether it is in-house or one hyperscaler. If you talk to them, you will realize they are using more than five or 10 providers on an average. And there are other customers or other enterprises who have cracked this puzzle on how to leverage multi-cloud for cost for performance and for good reasons around I'll talk about around the financial aspects of it as well, right? So this is what is happening in the application landscape. And now we look at a quick look at what is happening in the data landscape. So in the late data landscape, what is happening is like the red set of circle that you see, you can imagine that is one side of the coin, which was our traditional way that we have been dealing with data, mostly transactional data. So we developed the data model alongside the application, deploy them, and the data is serving the purpose of that particular application. But what we see happening on the right hand side, on the blue, is how data is becoming such a critical thing for, again, going back to our unique experience, like giving the users unique experience. There is a lot of the analytics world and the AI ML world that is happening on the right hand side. So that is where you create your machine learning models, the AI models, deploy them, feed the data, and then the insight again is going back into the transactional world. So the line between these two worlds are also getting thinner, and they are becoming exchanging data from one side of the coin to the other side of the coin. And you will see the concept of what is like the data fabric becoming more relevant these days, which is about how do I make sure that the right person has the right data at the right place and the right time, all of that, right? So this data fabric takes care of taking away the complexity from the user or the application side and takes care of making sure the data is available to the application at the time of the need. So why I'm bringing up all of these is to give you a perspective of when you look at hybrid multi-cloud, you have to think through all of these layers. Like I talked about multi-cloud infrastructure, the applications are changing, the data landscape is also changing. So let us look at the next part of it. So traditionally, what we were doing was to, we clearly knew where is our app, where is our infrastructure, where is our app running on this infrastructure, and what is the data that it is going to use. And we were looking at a deployment release model where lot of the stuff was related to, like, I might have three releases of my product or solutions in a year, or even better would be like I do a major release once in a quarter and some minor release in a monthly, weekly basis. But when we are talking about a cloud-based deployment, we're talking about the way the team culture is changing and the way we have to push code out continuously to the extent that you may be making like 200 pushes into production every day. If you have a large development unit and spread across multiple geos, maintaining this manually is going to be it's not possible. Let's take it that way. So now automation is a must. And then the same development team has to operate and run this. So when you connect this back to the previous diagram that I was showing, where the coexistence of the existing staff and the new staff, so you have to have a DevOps model where you are able to create the code, push the functionalities into the various target environments, whether it's the current environment, whether it is pushing to the coexistence infrastructure or the modern infrastructure. You need these pipeline of pipelines or the continuous integration, continuous deployment pipelines. And how you do it, how well you support, like you have options of chatbots and the AI ops and all of this to do the support and alerting mechanisms also. How well you do this and how you select your cloud, how you select your target deployment, all of this makes sense. So with that backdrop, now I want to switch to our topic around what is it for security in this? So this changes are happening at a rapid speed. Digitization is given, like if you have to survive in any of these domains, we talked about all of the banking, telco, retail use cases, you need to innovate at speed. And people are looking at these, creating these business platforms where you are bringing your partners, competitors, and other people onto the platform and then doing business. Then your applications are changing, your applications needs to transform, your data fabric needs to be implemented, and you have to do this on a continuous basis. Now, where does security fit in all of this? So that's where the traditional way of doing security was, let's go build, develop these applications, and then let's put the what we call the security or patch security towards the end. So that simply cannot work because the rate at which you have to address the the risk, the compliance, the controls, and meet the industry specific regulations before you go live, security also has to be automated, and security also has to what we call shift left in this journey in this pipeline for moving to hybrid multi-cloud. So let's go through what are those key dimensions. So another trend before I get into specifics around what we are going to deep dive. Another trend specifically with regard to security, what we see is things are moving from policies to controls where you know, the capability that we are looking at is like, okay, you have a service on the cloud or you have an application built on the cloud, but more than you know, addressing the capabilities of that application, what we also need to do is to make sure that that application is secure, and secondly, the application is compliant. So the application compliance requires that you understand what are the controls that are required, whether it is HIPAA for healthcare or PCI or federal for the government based applications. You have to understand the regulations and compliance and risk policies mandated by the industry and look at what is your enterprise controls framework provide to address those compliance requirements and get into how is it implemented on the specific application or capability that you are rolling out in the cloud. So there are two things when we talk about security and compliance. So we can be secure, but we may not be compliant. And there might be cases where you can show that, you know, I'm following all of the compliance stuff and you know, you can look at the controls and the implementation, but there might be gaps in that implementation which can lead to security exposures. So getting this together is again what I would call a hybrid model where you have secure engineering practices combined with a strong compliance and risk monitoring. So what we are looking at is not just meeting the you know, the policies, but we are looking at what are the right controls that we can define and how can we implement that. And it's not a one-time job as we know in the cloud already, because it has to be what we call as continuous security, and many of these require what you call these controls to be available, monitored across the life cycle, across the implementation and life cycle of these applications. And then you have stuff when we get into specific controls. Of course, many of the customers or enterprises that we talked to, the initial objective or objection to cloud was like, is my data safe on the cloud? So most of the clients again take a data-centric approach to cloud. So this journey actually is also triggering some of the thinking around, have I done my data classification correctly? And what is the data that we are trying to protect? So this is again, you know, insights that we see talking to the customers, like many customers try to do like a fit in a one size security architecture or data security architecture to their entire set of data. So the risk there becomes, you know, there was one of the conferences that I was attending similarly on the cloud security. So the speaker nicely put it like, if you are protecting everything, you are probably protecting nothing, because all of this comes with a cost. So the data classification and understanding what are your crown jewels and what are the ones that are like, if you look at classifications or public internal confidential, sensitive. So when you look at public, internal, there might be like information that are probably you can share it with internally or share it publicly outside, like material that is out there on the portal or product catalog or things like that. But there might be certain crown jewels which are your next blueprint for your next innovation platform, the blueprint for your next R&D project, or PII information which has to be confidential. So what is driving this is, like, you would see two sets of controls that are needed. One is like a set of controls that can deliver what is needed through operational controls. And secondly, you have to also think about what technical mechanisms or technical controls that you can put in place so that some of these aspects related to data security can be achieved. So in this example or in this slide, you can see that there is like a defense in depth pattern to put your sensitive data behind all of those security controls. And enterprises were doing it themselves in the past. So they would, I know my users, I know my perimeter, I know my infrastructure. I can feel where my application is running and I know where my database is. But then in the cloud side, there can be your threat and attack vector is, larger. You have like five different cloud providers, and then you need to know how are they keeping your data safe in their environment. So it is like a change of ownership, or it is like a shared responsibility model that you have in the cloud. So understanding these aspects are critical to addressing cloud security. And now this particular slide is one of the key slides that I would want all of you to take away when you're addressing cloud security. And it's not anything largely different from how you do traditional security, but there are few things, like I mentioned about this shared responsibility model, and there are few things that are different in the cloud that we should be aware of. But largely, the capabilities I want to focus on is the network security, the identity and access, application and endpoint, and data protection. With regard to network security, we know the typical things that are done in terms of keeping our boundaries secure, the defense in depth pattern that we were talking about. So you have these firewalls, you exactly know who is coming in and who needs to be blocked by the web application firewalls and the network firewalls at the layer 3, layer 7 levels. But also, what is getting important in the cloud related to network is, how do you do the network segmentation? How do you do the network micro segmentation and control the traffic between virtual private clouds and virtual servers or containers? And how do you control these traffic across your clusters also? Like, how do you manage only the data containers or data pods or the application pods are talking to your data pods and all of that? So that is a first set of capabilities. When we talk about identity and access, there are two aspects to this. One is related to how do you manage identity and access for the cloud itself. So you have users like the cloud administrators, the cloud users, all of them trying to access the cloud resources, and you talk about how to enable IAM, how to enable multi-factor authentication, how to enable privileged user management into these cloud resources. So that is one set of use cases and patterns that you would see. The second one is about, how do I manage identity and access for the applications that are deployed on my cloud. So traditionally, if we are talking about a monolith, as I'm entering that application, you can think about it like a big bungalow or a mansion. So there was only one single door, and if I'm able to get into that application, I can probably access any part of the application, any functions of the application. So it's like I get into this mansion and I can go to any of these rooms. But with the cloud native engineering, what is happening is the microservices based model is the preferred way to develop your application. So the principle there is you do one thing, and that one thing you do it right and make it highly available, highly scalable, and run it on a container or any such technologies where you can scale indefinitely. So I'm talking about the applications block in this picture. So this block again is going through a lot of changes how you address that. So comparing to the previous model, the monolithic model where identity and access needs to be managed, here you have a model where somebody has to enter one room. Again, you have to show your identity, your access, everything has to be validated. So the microservice, at each microservice, there is a gate which is checking for this. And there are, of course, optimizations and models that are coming up here through, implementing these checks as part of sidecars, as part of a service mesh, etc. So that's one aspect of it. And within the application security, so you have the user context. Let's say a cab driver accessing the cab hailing app. You have the user context, who is accessing what service or about that app, versus like a consumer or a customer of that app accessing that app, and what access can be provided to each of these users. So each of these microservices need to have the identity context of this end user. And apart from that, this also requires to have the identity context of the service that is invoking the service. So the actual business service, you can think of it as made up of a chain of microservices. So A calling B calling C. So there has to be service identities for A, B, and C, and then permissions, policies defined for each of these microservices, and how do you enforce that in your application. So a lot of interesting patterns that you will see in the identity and access patterns. Then with application security, again, the fundamental change that you see in the cloud world is that we have been doing stuff like hardening our VM, doing patch management to the machine where this application is running. So you have a application running on Red Hat or Linux or Windows, and you have the application code developed in one version of Java, .NET, Node.js, you name it. So you have a layer of dependencies from infrastructure to the application level. So just that you know, like I have used one version of a Node.js library that would have somebody would have identified a vulnerability in that today, and then I have to suddenly patch all of my applications using that library with the latest version of the library. So that is what we have been doing till now. Now, when we transition on over to the cloud world, the scenario is slightly changing. So if you focus on this container and VM part of it, we are looking at if I find that this container is vulnerable and is not good, I'm going to throw it away because it is doesn't cost me much to build a secure new container which doesn't have that vulnerability. So that is the way that you know, patch management, vulnerability management is being done in this part. Now we have to discuss this data security part. Along with that, we have to discuss the what you call the key management aspects of it as well. So again, before I go into the data aspects of it, so this is one picture that I would like all of you to take away from this session, which is basically how you look at the different subdomains. I have called out the top four. Of course, you have the physical, the governance, all of that, the SIEM, the visibility, all of that coming along. The security posture management and protection and response, all are other specific domains of cloud security. But essentially, these four are the important ones that you should get it right. Now, let me talk about what is happening with regard to data security and how do I make sure that data is secure in the cloud. So here we talk about two things. One, traditionally, when we say data security, there are two parts to it, or two critical elements to it. One is you keep your data at rest secure. And the method that we know how we keep our data at rest secure is encryption. But encryption is now what is what we call as old school, which still needs to be done. But in the cloud, the more powerful context is key management. Why? Because there is change of hands of ownership and there are two parties involved in making this successful. Like your data is in the cloud, so you need to be in control of that data. So which means if the provider says I have encrypted and kept your data safe, you don't trust that because there could be insider threats. So somebody can just take your database file and run it on another another system because he has the database file, he has the encryption key also with him. So there you see these patterns around BYOK, like bring your own key, keep your own key sort of models coming along, and multiple patterns there related to data at rest. So in the interest of time, I'm going to go into the next pattern, which is in data in transit, which is about how do I make sure that between these microservices, between these clouds, data is secure. So whether you know you have the user interface accessed by the application user, or when your microservices are talking to each other, ensure that they are talking secure through secure channels. So you have HTTPS, SSH, SSL channels established across your application to microservices and between microservices also. So certificate management becomes a key topic related to security in the cloud, where in the traditional days, you want certificate only for that this top layer where the you have www.xyz.com. There only you are talking about certificate, but not inside or between those rooms of the mansion. But in the cloud world, each of these services also needs identity, and there are a lot of interesting protocols and you know, tools and foundations that are coming along related to certificate and identifying or attaching identity to service microservices. So these two are sort of solved issues and data at rest and data in transit. But there is a third dimension to this, which is called data in use. And this is what you might come across as multi-level security as well as confidential computing. which requires you to have that technology assurance. So remember, I talked about the operational assurance and the technology assurance. So this is where, how do I make sure that the person having access or person running my application on the cloud doesn't have access to my data? So imagine you have a container that is running and you know, somebody can actually kill that container, get the process dump of that container and take a look at what was uploaded in the memory itself. So that is risky. Like if it is like a PII information, it is like a cryptocurrency. So I can steal that document from a running application. To prevent that, you have stuff like you can run your containers, your microservice in what we call as enclaves or secure containers. So even if what is stored in memory, which is running, is also encrypted, and then you have the option of providing your keys to manage that encryption as well. So ultimately, you are in control whether it is at rest, in transit, or in use. Now, putting this all together, another major trend that we see is about how, you know, from a perimeter-driven security, we are moving towards a zero trust model. So there is also a lot of secure history to this zero trust model that initially, you know, Jericho Forum came up with, and now, you know, the United States government also has prescribed to move towards a zero trust model, which is primarily not a product or one set of capabilities. It's a way that you think about the security. Like, you know, even the pandemic has accelerated this movement from, you know, looking at a perimeter-based security to like how can an employee access, you know, their resources, enterprise resources from any sort of network or any sort of device. So this, again, some of the concept taken forward by capabilities like BeyondCorp from Google, and you know, it's all leading towards what is like a zero trust. So zero trust again doesn't mean any single product, but how do you implement a set of principles in your overall architecture? Basically, you don't trust anything. You don't trust your infrastructure. You don't trust your application. You don't trust your data, or you don't trust your device. So across all of these, we'll have to have a way that we are looking at identifying and verifying. So always verify the element, and then based on the context, you are going to provide access to a particular asset. A simple example would be like if I'm accessing something really sensitive, I'm going to be, you know, not allowed if I'm accessing from a non-secure network or a jailbroken device, etc. So this is requires a lot of what you call analytics and context to be created before I can decide whether to allow or deny an access to a resource. And all of these operations, security is again a big data problem. We need cloud capability. So you have to define the context, and based on the context, I'm going to verify and enforce or allow and deny security for this. So putting this all together, like I said, in the cloud world, we have to shift left security. So security has to be part of this design, build, deploy, and manage. You can get more information around this from the secure engineering practices. So moving from DevOps to DevSecOps. So finally, when you are deploying to multiple of these environments, you also need a dashboard where we talked about visibility into like how am I doing against these risks, the controls, and you need that assessed and continuously monitored. So the security and compliance posture management is another big area for hybrid cloud security. So my intent was to just give you a flavor for what is happening in this landscape, how the enterprises are digitizing and what is out there. So probably I've taken most of my time, maybe a minute for the questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Srikanth. It was a wonderful session. Right now, questions are getting popped up. I think we may not have time to address it immediately. Let us take it little later. Probably I will continue with the next speaker. Before that, I will brief. I think Srikanth's presentation was wonderful, and how the data centric, and then how the protection of the data centric fabric, and then what automation this thing, and what are the key takeaways. Basically, how the app application containers can be, if there is a vulnerability, that can be thrown out, and then a new container can be refurbished kind of. So these are all very good tools, and definitely our members will get good benefit. Thanks a lot, Srikanth, once again.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to present here.
Okay. Let me introduce the next presenter. One second, guys. One second,
Chandraji, you are sharing your screen. First, you need to stop it and then reshare it again, the slides.
Okay, sure. Is it fine now?
Yeah, Anand, just wait for Chandraji to introduce you.
Sure.
Thank you so
much. Anand, 1 minute. Can you see the Anand Prakash screen? Can someone confirm?
Yes, Chandraji, we can see.
Yeah. Our next speaker is Anand Prakash. He is a security researcher and CEO at PingSafe, AppSecure, who is famous for finding bugs in some of the world's most popular apps and websites. He thrives off bug bounties, large cash prizes, he earns from companies in exchange for successfully hacking their systems and showing them their security flaws. And for the past 5 years, Facebook has ranked him as one of the top bounty hunters. And on Twitter, Uber, and LinkedIn bounty program, he is ranked among the top 5 worldwide. Anand's reputation as a hacker has made him featured in the Forbes list 30 under 30. Over to you, Anand.
Yes, thank you, sir. So good evening, everyone. Hope you are doing great. So this talk is mainly about attacking the attackers, how normally attackers think, and how they attack a company and get hold of their applications, cloud credentials, and other things. So this is about myself, top ranked hacker on Facebook, Uber, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Salesforce Bounty Program. I found bugs like hacking into anyone's Uber account, hacking into anyone's Twitter account without having any extra access, and deleting LinkedIn posts from any LinkedIn account in the world, and also taking over Facebook and Instagram account. So all these findings were ethically disclosed to these companies, and proper permissions were taken from these companies to disclose it out to the public. All these findings are public. So apart from this, I worked with more than 200 early stage startups since starting from 2015 till 2021, and I was also listed in under 30 list at age of 23. I would like to start with what exactly is the attacker mentality. Why is it important to understand as a hacker? So little bit moving before, so I started my journey as a bug bounty hunter in 2013, and I've been doing this since 2021, and there are ways in which attackers think and how they attack a company and how they get a hold of the sensitive data, or they end some end up in doing data breaches for companies. So we cannot win the battle if we don't understand the enemy. So we are sitting inside the company, and I don't think we'll be able to win the war if we don't understand how they actually work and what they actually do. The attacker mentality, what are our challenges? So technology changing at a very fast pace. So 5 years back, everyone was running applications in a data center, on-prem database data center. And now there is cloud everywhere, even banks, insurance companies, everyone has started moving to clouds. A lot of new technologies are getting introduced, for example, Kubernetes, containers, and apart from this, so lot of changes on the technology side as well. Earlier there was .NET, PHP, now there is Node.js, Java across the applications. So attackers' primary job is to hack, but our primary job is to run business smoothly. Apart from this, there is a significant increase in number of bug bounty hunters as well as black hat hackers, hence more security incidents. So there was a report from HackerOne, which is a leading bug bounty platform in the world, and they published this report 3 days back, and the report says there is a 12,268% increase in bug bounty reports related to cloud misconfigurations. So that's the report which came 3 days back, and apart from this, obviously there is increase in API related vulnerabilities as well. The attacker mentality, how they work. So I have kind of created this, and basically this flow diagram explains how a normal attacker would like to go in attacking a company. So for example, I'm an external person. I don't have access to anything which is internal to the company, but I will try to do. So as a hacker, as a bug bounty hunter, I will try to look out for all your public information, try to figure out your subdomains, your IP addresses, your GitHub repositories, your entire mobile APKs, IPA files, everything. So whatever is publicly accessible, I will try to figure that out. Then what I'm going to do next is, once I have this data, I'm going to run some analysis on it. I will try to figure out your open ports, which is the most basic obvious thing done by an attacker. Then I will try to figure out things like open directories. Then there is a new block, which is understand technology. So once I have the data, I will try to categorize everything into multiple technologies which the company is using. If a particular asset belongs to storage, if a particular asset belongs to queuing systems like RabbitMQ, if a particular instance is a container, if a particular instance is a monitoring tool like Grafana, Kibana, then once I have this data, everything clubbed into multiple things, I will try to I will try technology specific attacks. That this is all automated. This is not manual, so it's all automated, and we do it continuously rather than doing it quarterly or once in 6 months. So if your developer is putting up something live to production today, will be able to detect that immediately. If your developer is putting out your public secrets, your secrets on a public repository, will be able to figure it out immediately rather than after 6 months or in the next audit. So once I have
Anand, sorry to interrupt you, are you sharing your screen, because we just don't see it yet?
Okay.
Any presenting? Are you presenting anything?
Yes, I was presenting. One second. It somehow. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we see the slides.
Sorry. This is the basic flow diagram which attackers normally follow. So I was at the technology specific attacks. So once I have technologies and everything, I have the entire data set of a company, I'm going to automate it, and we'll try to figure out more in-depth attacks, like if there are any remote code executions, if there are any CVEs, I will try payload specific to it, and that also is automated these days. I will not even do manual intervention, and based on pattern matching, I will be able to detect if my payload was successful or not. Once the public information gathering part is done, then I will move on to AWS, your AWS environment, your Azure environment, your GCP environment. The way to figure this out is, once I have list of all your subdomains, your entire things, we'll go. We have something which reads your entire source code for all these domains, and based on few logics like what content, what data storage thing you use, we'll be able to detect if you are using AWS, Azure, or GCP.
Quick one. Still the sharing is not seen. Could you please check?
Okay, so I shared it, but it's still.
No, it's visible, no problem.
Yeah, it was visible, Chandraji.
Okay. Go ahead, please, sir.
Yes, so once I have your cloud footprint, I'm going to basically try attacks related to your cloud environment. For example, if there is SSRF, I'm going to try payloads related to AWS only. If there is Azure, I'm going to try payloads related to Azure only. So this is the pattern which we follow. Apart from this, we'll go to GitHub, Bitbucket, Gist, and we'll try to figure out your leaked source code, leaked secret tokens, and we'll try to relate this data to the subdomains or the assets which we have gathered earlier. Then there is a fourth thing which comes in, your Android apps, your iOS apps, your Electron apps, will get hold of all your apps, and that will be automatically decompiled, and will look out for things like your AWS access keys, your Azure keys, your Google Cloud keys, as well as your third party leakages. So this is all automated, and most of the attackers, everyone has kind of automated it. It's done very in a continuous fashion, and whenever you are deploying something, it's done every time. Okay, so yes, the problem is most of the companies, they do it once in a quarter. That's the problem, or they do it once in a month. So current interpretation of security for companies is like, mostly what we see is they mainly do it for compliance. Then the second is also compliance. Then the third is also compliance. So that's the that's not a problem. I do agree compliance has to be done. Compliance is 100% important. But what if we combine compliance with offensive security? So compliance and both, if both compliance and offensive security are done parallelly, then I think we'll be at a better position. The other problem is we quarterly penetration testing is not keeping up with fast paced development because of new changes getting deployed to cloud as well as daily deployments happening. Then there is a huge gap between conventional penetration testing and real world hacking techniques. So normally if I'm working inside a company and if I'm doing penetration testing or doing cloud audit, I'm only doing it for a specific set of assets. It's not like I'm doing it for the entire set of assets and if I'm relating the entire data set. And it's very different from real world hacking techniques. So ideal interpretation of security is compliance plus offensive security. Both should be done together. Yes, so why cloud security should be the first priority? So most of the data dumps which happen, right? Most of the data breaches which have happened in the past, if we go and look at the root cause for these data breaches, it's most of the time it's cloud security misconfigurations. And but it's always cloud security misconfigurations which lead to big data breaches. And also the attack surface has changed. So attackers map targets with technologies, they will look out for similar things across the internet. And it's just not just traditional CSPM solution anymore. It's not just you will run a rule based check across your cloud environment and that will give you complete coverage. You have to apply some context to it, and that has to be done. That has to be combined with the hacker based approach. So problem with traditional CSPM configuration based assessments based on rules, they will have some rules which will be evaluated at a specific set of time, and based on that the security vulnerabilities will be called out. No in-depth checks based on the context of the cloud service. For example, if I'm running a Kubernetes instance, so if the tool is a traditional CSPM, it's not going to attack my Kubernetes instance and it will try to figure out a vulnerability or latest CVEs on it. And it's not going to confirm if the payload really worked or not. Apart from that, there is a zero visibility from hacker's perspective. The tool is only giving you full detailed summary about your cloud environment, cloud security posture. But what if the tool combines hacker's perspective as well? Then there are a lot of false positives and low severity alerts. You would see a lot of alerts, but only a few of them are critical and exploitable from outside. So these are some of the open source tools which can be used for doing basic assessments around your cloud environment. These have been used by companies from a very longer time, and for example, SecurityMonkey, Prowler, ScoutSuite by NCC Group, these kind of tools. But the problem remains the same. I'm not sure. Okay. So then there is a problem with attack surface risk monitoring solutions. So most of the attack surface and risk monitoring solutions, they use black box approach to figure out the risk exposure of a company, because most of them are meant to do work in that way. And they use third parties to figure out your public assets, brute forcing, which results in less asset discovery. But if since I am already having access to the cloud environment, I basically scan it continuously, and if new assets are getting introduced, I scan them immediately and prevent the leakage over there itself, rather than that alert popping up in a risk monitoring solution at a later point of time. Then the vulnerability detection there is a vulnerability detection which is being done by these tools, but I would say the verification part is missing. But what hackers are doing is they are doing both verification as well as the detection part. False positive because the tool obviously has lesser data because of the black box approach. So some of the tools which are out there in market, right, they have started combining cloud with their current risk monitoring solutions portfolio. They have started gathering assets from the risk monitoring from companies' cloud environment as well. They have started giving options to the customer to connect their cloud account and get more correct and more accurate results in the tool, but most of them don't. So a solution is combined intelligence is the solution, combining hacker-based approach plus the traditional CSPM tools which are out there in market. So if we combine both of them as well as we integrate the traditional the compliance, whatever compliance is there, as well as the cloud governance portion. So if we combine all four of them and if we provide complete visibility to the company from hacker as well as from compliance, we kind of shift left and that tool is in-house to the company and detects things before it's even detected by external hackers. So this is the result and risk monitoring solutions, and that results appear in bug bounty reports later. And the tool should have ability to block changes in CI/CD, and it should auto remediate some part of it. And as well as the product should kind of provide complete external exposure, but the hacker is kind of seeing things from outside. So these are some of my bug bounty findings, which are very common. So developers put AWS credentials on a public repository, and this could have led to data extraction. So this was submitted to a company named Soup.com, and this company got acquired by Amazon. So the developer, you have 1,000 developers, 2,000 developers working in-house, and most of the companies outsource the development as well. But how do you kind of monitor it? So people like me try to figure this out, and if you clearly see at the screenshot, there is the AWS key and secret of that particular company. It's deactivated, it's not active right now because this issue got fixed, but these mistakes are done because we are fixing the traditional things from inside company, but not the what hacker is really doing, and that results in more data breaches. So there was another issue which was figured out by a security researcher named TXT3Rob and in Snapchat, and he was heavily rewarded. There was a exposed Kubernetes API which was giving access to the entire internal network of Snapchat. So basically, if you look at the summary, right, during a worldwide Kubernetes scan, so this is what people normally do. They will do a worldwide scan. It's all automated. It's continuously running on weekends as well, and they will try to figure out everything related to your company immediately rather than waiting for a longer period of time. So ideally we should follow an approach where these things are figured out before someone else figuring out in the world, and then able to extract data of the company from outside. So I'm going to give you a basic demo of context-based vulnerability which can lead to AWS key leakage from a public endpoint. So we have prepared this. So 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 this is a sample application which have been prepared by us, and if you look at the application, this application is basically allowing the user to view document which are getting uploaded by them. And if you look at the URL, if the URL is basically this is the URL, it's some S3 bucket and KYC user. And if you look at the URL, it's proxy.stream origin. So proxy.stream is basically it's exposed by Hysterics dashboard, and they had a CVE related to it. So if a company is using Hysterics dashboard, and if there is a CVE, if that Hysterics dashboard
Anand, you went on mute accidentally, it seems.
No, it's...
Okay, let me check one. Trainer one.
Yes, you have been muted.
Yeah, to mute all participants. Just try. You can continue now.
Okay. Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. So this application basically gives you allows the user to download the KYC documents uploaded by them. And what the attacker is, this vulnerability is detected when you are running the Hysterics dashboard. So once the attacker is going to gather your cloud related assets, they are going to categorize it in different texts like Hysterics and Apache and Nginx and everything. And if they find Hysterics, they are going to simply run this payload to get access to your cloud environment. So this URL is kind of leaking your AWS access key ID and secret key, which can be used by someone to extract data from this instance. So if we go to the backend right, so yes, so this is the flow diagram. So once the attacker has got access to your cloud assets from outside, they are going to detect technology, it's Hysterics dashboard, then they are going to try all the attempts related, they are going to attempt all the payloads related to multiple CVs related to Hysterics. They will try to fingerprint it if they can. Then will try to then they will try to figure out what cloud environment, what cloud provider you are using, whether it's AWS, GCP, or Azure. Since this CV is related to SSRF, they will try to figure out if they will try the payload related to that cloud provider only. Once they try all the payloads, they will try, store request and response of all the payloads, and they will automatically extract keys and check if the keys are valid. They will also try to figure out other variants, like if there is if they can access admin panel or blind, they can do blind attacks, blind SSRF on the same URL, and they will check if the tool is going to check if auto remediation is possible. So for example, the tool can be kind of integrated with any of your WAF providers like Akamai or any other provider, and using their APIs it can auto remediate as well if it's simply based on the request response and and then they are going to re-verify if the key leakage is still happening. In parallel, the tool is going to kind of automatically create alerts and tickets for your teams with a proper thing that the exploit was successful and it was able to extract keys of your AWS account. So if we go by the traditional tools which does cloud security, right, they will not be able to detect such kind of attacks. They will probably run some the basic configuration checks and will say this machine is open to public, the port 22 or some export is open to public. But they will not be able to do such in-depth analysis by applying context to it. And the other scenario is, let's say if the same URL is getting exposed to outside, for example, on GitHub, Gist, or Bitbucket, Pastebin, or somewhere else on dark web, then if the same tool can kind of crawl the entire space to figure out more accurate results because they have already access to your cloud environment. So that was mainly about it. So the key takeaways are if we have to get all tools to work, we will have to think like an attacker. The tool will have to think like an attacker rather than doing a single thing. It has to be combined using multiple things. But the attack, we have to be more faster than attackers. If some new payloads are getting released today, they should be in the tool immediately and they should be scanned across the entire internet. The entire asset base of the company. And apart from this, so let me give you another example. So when we work with a lot of companies, right, most of the times, let's say if it's an insurance company, they have multiple apps or multiple cloud environments related to different apps. So if it's an insurance company, most of the times we hear that this app is only accessible to a limited set of users. Only agents can access it. In case of Uber, you cannot access Uber driver because app, because you will have to get registered Uber, you will have to do KYC and things. But these people, actually attackers, actually register as an insurance agent to get hold of your database. You are doing activity on that cloud environment, or you are doing activity on that app once in 6 months or in a quarter. But attackers do it. They register themselves and then they try to dump the data from over there. So that's the main key point I would like to say. So we have to think like attackers, both with respect to app security, cloud security, and apply context to even faster than the attackers. Thank you.
Your slide share is stopped, maybe.
Yes, so that was it, and that was the key. Yes. Hello.
Chandraji, yes, thanks, Anand. Okay. Chandraji is on mute.
Yes, sorry, there was some issues with my internet. Maybe it was going back and forth.
No, that's not a problem.
Chandraji, you are on mute.
No, again, someone is trying to mute there.
No worries. Yeah.
I have clicked again. It is unmuting, it says.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. Anand, the question is, what are the top three application security in SaaS applications? And what is the best practice for securing APIs? So this is one question we have.
Yes, so as per the report by multiple bounty platforms, right, the most critical one is insecure direct object reference, which is mainly getting access to other users' data, and basically circumventing access control of the application. The second one, which is kind of more related to cloud, is SSRF these days. So with introduction of cloud, you would find more SSRF, as well as there are other traditional issues which you would find, which are categorized into OS top 10 category. So it's mostly insecure direct object reference most of the time.
Okay. Can you hear me? I think somewhere it is getting muted for me. I'm not sure.
Okay, I can hear you.
Okay. This is the next one is why companies are still not learning, as we can find some low hanging fruits on Shodan, or are they honeypots?
Some of them are indeed honey pots, but the other problem is, even if we go to Shodan today and if we put country India, China, US, you would find a lot of exposed instances, and most of them they don't know about it. While working with these companies, what I have learned in the past, right, they really don't know about Shodan, that someone is searching them continuously and your IPs are getting listed somewhere, your MongoDB instances which are open to public are getting listed somewhere, and someone can see them and get hold of dump your database. That's the problem. So the security industry, they know it, but the other space who are just getting started into security, they don't know about it, that the assets, your assets are getting listed over Shodan.
That is wonderful. Yeah, thanks a lot for your insights, Anand. It was a wonderful session, and hope you are keeping your defenses in good stand, because you are attacking the attackers, that the defense should be strong from your end. Thanks. Yes. Once again, I have a question for Shrikant. Shrikant Iyer, could you please, you can stop presenting Anand. I think I will ask a question to Shrikant. Shrikant, the question is, monitoring for hybrid cloud by a unified solution, how practical is that? Shrikant, can you present and answer? Can you unmute and answer, please?
Yeah.
You want me to repeat the question?
Hold on.
I need not share, Shrikant. You can just take up the question. That should be fine.
Yeah, you can just answer the question, Shrikant. Can you repeat the question, Shrikant?
Yeah, is it audible now? Because having some challenges unmuting.
Yes, it is audible, Shrikant. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Good question. This is there is no such single solution which you can use to do observability across multiple clouds. But there are few vendors out there who are coming out with some interesting solutions. Again, considering some common denominators, whether it is containers, Kubernetes, these you consider as common denominators. Specific solutions from different vendors, including Red Hat, Instana, lot of capabilities are there for these monitoring aspects. Now there are two sets to this. One is like, how do you collect or enable this telemetry? Like, what is the data that you want to collect, and putting the right hooks. And second part is like, how do you leverage insights from this? So for example, if I talk about the way that different vendors and hyperscalers like are doing, is to provide a uniform way to connect to that data lake, the data lake of security events, and then you have intelligence tools working on those tool sets to create insights. So Styx is one of the standard that is used, and IBM and a couple of other, a group of companies are supporting this as a standard, and you have a standard way to get the vulnerability details and the threat details into a data lake. And then,
Thanks a lot, Shrika. I think hope that answered the question. Let me introduce the panel discussion for today. Can you guys see my screen?
Not yet, Chandraji. Chandraji, do you mind if I take over?
Oh, I am sharing. Can you please confirm? Can you see the screen now?
Not yet.
Okay, let me start introducing the speakers for the panel discussion today. Okay, I think you can see the screen now, right?
Yes.
Okay. Let me put it full screen. Okay. Is it visible now? Okay. So we have an interesting set of panel speakers today. And Anand Tapikar, he is the Director of Cybersecurity, GE Healthcare. And Benny Joseph, he is a Product Security Leader at GE Healthcare. And he is a CSSP and has got a line of experience on his credit. And Ravindra Kumar, he is a security architect at Google, and he is an architect on Google Cloud, and he will be answering any of your questions with respect to Google Cloud and Google Cloud architecture or any of the other challenges. And to moderate this, I welcome Mr. Krishna Pandey. He is a senior manager security engineering at Citrix, and he is our president of the ISE2 Bangalore chapter. Over to you, Krishna, and other panel speakers.
Thank you, Mr. Chandra. We are really glad to have this esteemed panelist. Just before, Ravindra, we cannot see your video. I hope you can come online. Hey, welcome to the panel. And so just a little housekeeping. Let me put my phone on mute. And just wanted to announce the winners for our community partner who provides regular certified courses. This one is Certified DevOps Security Practitioner. So ICSquare Bangalore chapter gives regularly one or two coupons, free passes to these trainings, which are worth $200. So this time the winners for this training series, which is happening on 27th to 29th, this is a 12-hour training. The winners are Kishore Chandrapalan and Ankush Jain. So congratulations to the winners. You get a 12-hour training program for 4 hours, 3 days each from our community partner, NII. Said that, so let me, before I actually go to Anand, Benny and Ravindra for our panel discussion, I would just like to set a little bit context, because whenever we talk about security in the cloud or even on-prem, so authentication and authorization are two most fundamental considerations. So this has become more critical given the pandemic situations where the employees are forced to work from home and remote. And a lot of companies now are actually considering full-time remote employees as well. And this means like you are accessing data from a lot of uncontrolled environments. So we will start the panel discussion with discussing identity and hovering around this concept called zero trust approach. So we will talk about that aspect, and then we will venture into the other topics, which is about around the edge computing. So my first question to Ravindra is, what are the upcoming trends in securing identity in the cloud? And what do you think are the next emerging technology which will come around that?
Yeah, so can you hear me, Krishna?
Yes.
Yeah, so basically what exactly we were using in our previous, the world or the era, like we were totally focused on the perimeter, like where we were trying to connect to the VPN, and then we were trying to access the applications. But now everything is inverted. At that time, we were getting the 80% of the traffic from inside our branch office, our locations or somewhere, and 20% of the traffic from the internet. But now the everything is inverted, and we are getting the 80% of the traffic from the internet, because most of the organizations are either moved or they are moving to the cloud. And we are running on the cloud, so everything is connected to the internet mostly. And the next thing which we are focusing here is, like, we are going beyond corp. We are not just thinking like maybe we are going to access our application through the perimeter network only. We are going to trust that particular network. But identity is the new perimeter. You need to give the free hand to your users or the customers or whoever is accessing your applications, your data, or whatever you are providing, so that they can access it from anywhere. So the new horizon, the new thing is the identity. So identity will become the next perimeter for this world.
All right. Thanks, Ravindra, for the great insight. Let me
like
go.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure, Anand. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So now if I look at the identity in the newer world, earlier also, as you said, identity is new parameter. There's a one more dimension coming to it, that identity is no more the user identity. Identity is gone much beyond that, right? Identity is gone. I'm sure Ravindra will agree to me that identity. The device identity of a service, identity of other application who are accessing my application, those things are becoming even more challenging now because there is no human involved there. But the same level of trust, same level of access, same level of roles, same level of permission needs to be maintained. So identity world has really exploded. That's what I just wanted to put across, adding to the Ravindra's thought.
Yeah, so that's very true, because maybe meantime, we are not just using the humans to access our data and application, but at the same time, we are using the different things, the different devices, the automation we are using, and everything needs some kind of identity. And that is the Anand was mentioning. So I'm completely agree with Anand that yes, we are going beyond humans, and we need to secure our devices. We need to give them identity, and how we can identify and can provide the access at the same time.
Yeah, that's actually great. So this gives me a perfect segue to ask Benny. So I was going to ask, like, add more IoT scenarios to it, and like, how do we implement security around the edge? Because edge computing is the next thing, like where we are making decisions. If you talk about autonomous vehicles or if you talk about smart devices, the traditional approach was like you are sending data from the IoT to cloud and then use AI. But increasingly, the decisions are being made on the edge. So what are you think, what are the challenges there, or how can we secure edge devices?
Actually, in the edge scenarios, because earlier when we think of IoT, it's small devices and small devices which will send some small amount of data to the cloud. But now in the new business world, a larger device starts to send data to the cloud, and in that scenarios, it will be sending sometimes a huge amount of data to the cloud compared to the earlier IoT small devices. So when we are having large devices sending data to the cloud, the data security itself becomes very important. And also we need to have the proper the identity of your edge devices, because the cloud might be operated by a cloud provider, and also might be a platform. Some business might be operating this platform, and these devices might be distributed across the globe and owned by a different business. So how we will be able to establish the identity of these edge devices is a very important fact, because the edge devices might be actually purchased and owned by these different businesses. And these devices can be even accessed by the different businesses who are purchasing these devices. They will have normal access, or even they will have even a root access to the device. So securing those devices' identity and how efficiently we will be able to establish a trust when we are communicating towards the cloud, that has become very important.
Thanks, Vinny. So exactly the same thing. So earlier when we were using the perimeter network, then the authentication we are trusting like the IP based. If you are in the same perimeter network end, we were thinking like you are a trusted member and you can access whatever we are providing you the access. But in the case of IoT, they are everywhere and they need some kind of identity. And the problem is then we can't bake anything like the credential or anything into those devices, so that we can maybe just go and maybe the device is going to be authenticated with those credentials, because there are multiple things related to that. There are multiple risks with those devices where we need some kind of mechanism so that we can maybe identify each and every device uniquely and then provide the access whatever they are relying on.
So
in that case, this SASE is becoming very important, that the secure access service edge SASE is an emerging cybersecurity concept. How do you secure your edge devices, and how you are ensuring that you are sending your data securely to your cloud? Because in the cloud also, we need to go into the zero trust network. And we are not even completely trusting everything on the cloud. Basically, I feel like we are going back to the old security paradigm of defense in depth. Because earlier we were having the security on the network side, but nowadays that has changed. So the importance of this network security has diminished, and the identity-based security has increased. So now we are having a balance of that thing when we think of this zero trust network.
Yeah, so there is a difference, Benny. Like maybe earlier we were having the concept that verify but trust. But now we are telling in the case of zero trust that always verify, do not trust. So whenever we are talking about zero trust, like we are going to verify each and every time whenever the things are going to be accessed from somebody. It may be the devices, it may be the application, it may be the human users.
Yeah, I think that sums it up. And that actually gives us also kind of some edge into the kind, like insight into the edge and IoT scenarios. And yeah, SASE is one topic which we are going to touch definitely in this panel discussion. But before that, I want to go to Anand, given his expertise in the cloud native security. So Anand, what do you think challenges? Like, a lot of legacy companies are now trying to move to SaaS. Like, they have been licensing model, now they are moving to more subscription based model. And like everybody's trying to be a SaaS company. But do you think, like, because you know that simply lift and save does not work in the cloud. So what are the key challenges or building blocks in securing SaaS applications?
Yeah, as you said, Krishna, that the organization wants to have the application on the cloud and they want to provide service for very obvious reason of a business reasons, because one time you invest and then you sell that application subscription to the multiple users, multiple organizations, you make money out of it. I don't want to go the business part of it, but if you look at the technical part of it, it is a one data center, one applications, which you have to put all the controls and that you have to secure it. So that means the cost of a control, cost of ownership as compared to the on-premise application is quite reduced in the cloud SaaS case. So definitely it makes sense for the many organizations to go for the SaaS kind of application, deploy, provide those services which are required by the users, and many healthcares are not going behind in that. And many fintech companies are providing it. And I mean, we are very used to those kind of services. Now, how people are doing it? Now, there are multiple challenges comes when we talk about the SaaS kind of application. The one of the biggest challenge is the multi-tenancy. And some people who attended yesterday's session, and there was a takeaway from that session on the multi-tenancy, that it is a very complex thing. And one of the takeaway, what I got it from that session is that multi-tenancy is not in just in the identity or in the data or on the storage. It is everywhere. Whatever you do in those SaaS application, everywhere you need to have those multi-tenancy built in. That means the one customer who is trusting you for their data, for their system, for their organization's principles, may not like to share those things with the others also. That may happen. And that is why we have to keep that kind of balance between the one customer's access versus the other customer access, what is shared, what is not shared. That has to be completely transparent to the customer. The second thing comes that business models along with that. That, okay, your data is coming. If you are going to store the data in a common database, if you're going to have a database as a service, as a one of the component, and we will do a multi-tenancy there, the cost of that will be lesser. Versus if you go to the silo model completely, then the cost of that access will be the higher. So those kind of discussion happens with the customers, and we come up with the right kind of model in that situation. And that's how it goes. There are certain things still remains common, for example, the network, the underlying cloud services, etc. But that is fine. I mean, people have accepted it. There is a reasonable amount of confidence among the clients that, okay, the organization who is providing these SaaS applications will take care of those kind of concerns. And there is a there are some certifications also helps, like ISO 27001, HITRUST in case of HIPAA. Then there is a GDPR based some services certification, BAA certification. All these things helps to the client to get assurance that, okay, these guys are following those principles. And one of the good takeaway I got it from the Anand Prakash session, that good mixture of offensive and the compliances is very much required. If somebody is trusting a data, one breach can erode that trust. And that is what I keep saying to my internal customers, that we have to every day assume that we may get attack. There are people out there whose business is to get attack you and ask for the money or do something bad about it. So that's you have to really work towards it. You have to make sure that your application, both offensive and compliance based security, is all in place, and you take care of client's data as if it is more important than your organization data. So you have to give a more importance to that data. You have to take care, you have to ensure the backup, your business continuity and everything. So there are multi challenges. I mean, for the discussion sake, I'll just pause here. Maybe some more questions come.
Yeah, so thanks Anand for explaining that maybe what are the challenges we have for the SaaS model. But apart from it, that is the one aspect. Like you are just talking about the data privacy, that how we are dealing with. But apart from it, we have other challenges, like how we are going to mitigate the other attack vectors. Like, you know that we are having the DDoS kind of attacks, and apart from there are the web application type of attacks, which we can face. So we need some kind of controls. Like earlier, we were configuring the controls, we were maybe configuring the regexes to meet some kind of rules. But now the technology has changed. Attackers are getting the enhanced technologies in their hand, and we also need to improve from our side. So we need some adaptive controls. It means, like, if we have configured a web application firewall to secure our application, then it is not just providing you the security with the configured rules, but at the meantime, it is detecting the signature, it is checking that what are the rules we have configured, and the same thing, it is doing like the adoption, like what kind of the traffic we are getting towards our application, and then automatically blocking if it seems suspicious. So we need some kind of the security which is adaptive, not just the static configuration.
Sure,
Yeah, I think Ravindra definitely. So I was coming to that part. So because as we all have been talking about defense in depth and layers and different security layers, and if you see that there are a lot of solutions which keeps on augmenting each other. If you like Benny just briefly touched upon the SASE thing, and there are WAF solutions, there are DDoS prevention, bot mitigation. Like there are so many. Entire ecosystem of vendors around like protecting defense mitigation response, like all these solutions, right? So and in fact the Gartner also says that like by 2024 at least 40% of enterprises will have explicit strategies to adopt SASE, because like, and in year 2018 it was just 1%. So there are like very going to be a critical building block in terms of protecting the things. So I would request Benny, like, what do you think? What are your viewpoint against like these solutions, like WAF, SASE, and other prevention technologies, which are becoming more prevalent with the increasing cloud adoption? Benny, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, so this SASE is becoming very prevalent. It's very important emerging cybersecurity concept. And it's a cloud delivered service model based on the identity of the entity. And also we are considering the real-time context of context in which this operation is being invoked. And also maybe this enterprise policies and other things are also continuously assessed, and also the risk and other things are also being assessed in the real time. So this is becoming very, very important model for accessing the cloud services from the edge and also from the on-premise solutions. So. And SASE delivers network security services like cloud access service brokers and other things. And it is interfacing with the cloud. And we are able to secure our data, which is going forth from on-premise to the cloud and also from the edge to the cloud.
All right.
I want to mention that the organizations are still trying to adapt the zero trust. But if we are talking about the SASE, then it is the next step after the zero trust. Because whenever we are talking about the SASE, then in that case, we need the other components as well. Like we need the zero trust network, we need the cloud security, like the CASB and other things, the SD-WAN we need to configure with. So these other components we also need to adopt. If we are still in the phase of adopting the zero trust, then we are just maybe started. If we want to just go for the SASE, then we need the like the long journey.
Absolutely.
Anand, do you want to add something to it?
Yeah. What I'm saying is that, rather than going into those compliances standard like SASE and Zero Trust, first, as Ravindra also said, and Penny also mentioned it, that it is a journey, right? It is a journey where we first get our house in order with all the stuff what we were talking since last 2 days. That get those house in order and then go for those kind of framework which will give us a leap forward toward the security paradigm, right? So that we are talking about zero trust, but I still don't see many organizations are implementing it correctly. They call it zero trust in a different way, which is a more like an identity with a giving identity to the users or device or anybody for the time being. So that is not really a complete zero trust model, but still that is a good step, and I would suggest that people should work towards it. But at the same time, keep the all the house in order, at least to avoid the attackers, which as Anand Prakash has spoken, we have to move really ahead of those attackers as a security defense professional.
Yeah, and I just also wanted to touch upon, like, we have been talking about rule-based detection, rule-based prevention. Like, are we giving also any thoughts to lot of AI-enabled attacks, like where we are having polymorphic attack vectors and like the signatures, they can evade the signatures on the fly, they are generating new signatures, right? So how to bypass, like there are a lot of research around bypassing the WAF itself. So yeah. What are we doing on those fronts?
So I would say this is one of my colleague used to describe cat and mouse game. So sometime whatever control you will put, attackers will know, because they have a hundreds of opportunity to bypass us, right? They keep attacking and there one time they will get succeed. But for us, it's a one opportunity to buy something and put that those control in place. So pattern-based technologies were there, I think I should say 5 years back. Now everybody is coming up with the AI enabled, and they know, you talk to any company which were there in the same solution, they all are AI enabled now. What they are doing it, they are reading the data, they are creating the model. Every day they are feeding into the model, their model are becoming every day intelligent. They are putting those models, like companies like, I don't want to name, but just for a reference, I'm not recommending anything, like CrowdStrike type of company, that they are actually doing this analysis in the background. They are collecting the data from many different small endpoints and they are building it. And then there is an agentless methodology they work, and they actually work through those mechanism. So there is an intelligence getting shared between the multiple companies, and that's how we need to go. Alone, if I think that okay, I know everything and I don't need some partner, that won't be good enough. I need to have a partner, but at the same time, I need to have those policies, procedures, and technology just to secure my infrastructure.
Yeah, so I want to add two things, what Anand just mentioned. So the first thing is, like, we are using the AI ML. Why? Because we are generating lots of data and no human can process this data efficiently with the minimum time. We are having the IoTs, we are having the different customer base, maybe all over the world. So in this scenario, the lots of data we have. So if human is going to just process this data, then it will take some time. So what we need is, we need help from the technologies where we can process maybe near real time and can identify what exactly is happening inside the logs, or what type of the maybe attacks, what type of the requests we are getting towards our application. And the second thing is, like, if we are processing this data with the help of AI ML, then we can identify the anomalies. And these anomalies can further maybe analyzed to identify the patterns, that these patterns based attacks were happening and how we can prevent them. So these two things are very important here.
Yeah, so
and
add what Ravindra told. Because AI will help us to just predict what is the future. So that is important, because if you are handling a huge chunk of data, it won't be able to process that thing in real time and respond to that. So if you are able to predict the future with the help of AI, then we can even prevent zero-day attacks as well. So that's why the importance of the AI ML will help in protecting our cloud with the help of that technology.
Sure, thanks, Benny. So I think keeping in view the mind, like, because anyway, we have also need to have some time for Q&A. So let's go and touch upon, like, we have been talking about security by design, security in layers, like defense in depth, and like zero trust and everything. But because the main crown jewel or asset we are protecting is the data, because data is now everywhere. So when we talk about data, then we also need to briefly touch upon at least privacy by design and privacy aspects of the things. And like our sponsor, GE Healthcare, being in the healthcare, like where they are dealing with the PHI informations. it is like really critical to touch upon the privacy aspect as well. So I would like to give few minutes to kind of discuss how we are kind of encrypting the patient's data. Are there any, you know, emerging technologies on the encryption standards? How are we processing the workload? So maybe Anand or Benny, you can take it up first.
Yeah, Benny, you go ahead.
Yeah, so the PHI data is more critical compared to any other industry. Like in the payment card industry, we are having credit card data and all. And if we lose the patient data, which is more costlier in the market. So, and also it's always critical to the health of a patient. So we should not even allow any attacker to compromise or modify. Even if it is compromised, that may not even give that much threat. But if some of the patient data, like some of the imaging device data is compromised, because I remember long time back in Israel, one of the attacker has demonstrated that when this patient data getting transferred, they can even change the image of the data to look like the patient is having the cancer. So that is very dangerous and alarming situation. So it is very important in the healthcare industry to protect the PHI data, and we are awakening and we are having all the security controls and the encryptions of securing the patient data.
Yeah, so I want to mention here, like, the threats are not just maybe how you are dealing with the PHI, how you are storing the PHI data in your hard drives or somewhere, or maybe you are using that TLS everywhere to encrypt the data in transit. But the problem is one more thing, which is whenever we are processing this data, then this data needs to be in decrypted state. And maybe you have already heard the Spectre meltdown in 2019, I think. Then the attackers were able to access the application memory and were able to steal whatever you were processing in the memory. So as I have already mentioned, like, maybe the attackers are getting advanced. So you need to protect your data even when you are doing the processing. So it is called the homomorphic encryption, basically. But the full homomorphic encryption is still not practical. Why? Because there the maybe some kind of the POCs are going on. It is in the development phase where researchers are doing some kind of POCs and they were able to do some kind of steps, but we were able to encrypt the memory. Whenever the data, your application is decrypting the data and storing in the memory, then we are able to encrypt that particular memory with the help of secure encrypted virtualization, which is provided by, like, the second generation AMD ePyc processors, where the keys are stored and generated by the hardware and not exportable. So if your application is decrypting data and is storing in memory, then the hardware is again encrypting that particular memory until it is going to be processed by the processor. But when you say the full homomorphic encryption, in that case, we are going to say, like, even the processor is not knowing the exact data. But till now, we are successfully able to encrypt our memory until it is going to process by the processor.
That's good. That's great. It's good to know.
Now, actually, that is very important in the healthcare industry as well, because if the processor is not the business entity which is generating the data, and we are anywhere dealing with the patient data, so patient should get the trust of the companies and the processors who are dealing with the data. If the patient data is brought into the cloud and then processed. Nowadays, the companies are started processing the PHI data on the cloud. So in that case, it is very important to think of in that direction, like a homomorphic encryption, where we give the assurance to the organizations and also to the patients that their health data are not being compromised by some adversaries and other bad actors.
Yeah, because the threats are not external only. they are insiders as well. So we are having the internal and external both threats, and we need to consider them whenever we are dealing with such sensitive data. And we can maybe just go the authentication and authorize the access to somebody. It may be your employee as well.
Yeah.
All right, so I think we are about just 1 minute from the time. So I will just try to take a couple of questions for all of us. So one question we have on the SASE side, it looks like it is very popular. So somebody is asking that, hey, we have been talking about CASB for like last 10 years. Why we need SAS and like a SASE thing? And like, why is it replacing the CASB? And what are the extra things which is coming in the SASE solution?
So I can answer that. So this CASB is basically the cloud access security broker, which is part of this SASE solution. We can consider this as a part of the broker, which is trying to enable the security while we are transferring or while we are establishing the connection from your edge to the cloud. And it also offload the all security services at the edge side. And also it will be able to talk to the cloud side counterpart, and we are providing the secure access. And it's not like in the olden days we were having VPN, which you established from your on-premise to your cloud. Then the entire network would be accessible to everyone. But in case of when we are bringing up the CASB and the SASE solution, then we are isolating that, and only the data path which is flowing from the edge to the cloud will be encrypted, and a tunnel equivalent to VPN will be established, but with the limited access.
Yeah, because the CASB is the one aspect of that particular security. But whenever we are talking about the SASE, then we have the other components. Like, we need to build the Zero Trust network. We need the full-fledged cloud security and the SD-WAN implementation as well for the enterprises. So CASB is just the one component.
Sure. So I think we are about on time. Anand, do you want to add something to that?
No, not general. I mean, in general, I am saying that any standard which comes takes time, and it's a market forces that determines that which standard will become de facto or which will go further. So it's not that our technical competence or our security researchers' technical competence. It is a market forces that determines which solutions or which kind of standard will come. So that context, I want to give it to the answer to the question.
And I think I can just take one question which I just arrived. So what do you think about how often we should audit service accounts users if on automatic monitoring is not set up? Like, there are machine users, there are service accounts which are running the services, and these are not human users. So how should we audit, and how frequently we should monitor if there is no continuous monitoring?
Yeah, I should say, the two parts to this also. One is a compliance angle, another is a security angle. If I wear a compliance hat, then every compliance standard, like for example HIPAA, or we're talking about GDPR or any other ISO 27001 or anything, they talk about the periodic frequency of auditing these user account, have a user attestation, which are live, which are not live. But that are the compliance angle to it. And that you have to follow as per your industry. If you're in finance, you follow the PCIDS, et cetera, et cetera. If you're in healthcare, you follow HIPAA, like that. But if you wear a security angle, I should say that even for 1 hour, I don't want illegitimate user. I mean, 1 hour is also too large. I don't want an illegitimate user to accessing my application. So I need to have a continuous way of authenticating. For example, you must have seen now, if you're accessing the authentication of a these nowadays application, they have OTP, they have authentication, they have checks. Suppose you enter three times something wrong, they have another authentication pops up, you have to supply something. But there is a continuous attestation of an audit, or you can say attestation goes on. That is the way we have to think through nowadays. There's no more somebody auditor sitting there with taking all the users and checking it. No, not anymore.
All right. I think, yeah, thank you, Anand, for a great answer. And I would like to thank Benny and Ravindra as well. It was really an insightful discussion. And definitely, I want to thank all the chapter members and the attendees who have spent a couple of hours on weekend to kind of learn from the great speakers. And definitely that shows the enthusiasm. And yeah, so I think so this is the second, as I announced in the yesterday's keynote, this was the second in the webinar series, which is sponsored in the by the GE Healthcare. There are two more quarterly webinar series which are yet to come up. So stay tuned for the next announcement. We will be shortly finalizing the theme for that webinar series. And yeah, stay tuned. And just one plug before we end, if you are interested in becoming the IC Square Bangalore chapter members, please visit the IC Square Bangalore chapter website, and it has a page there, and you can find all the relevant information there. And thank you everyone for and have a great evening.
Thank you, Krishna.
Thanks.
And thank you,
Krishna. Thanks, Anand. Thanks, Benny.
Thanks, Pavinda. Thanks, Anand.
Bye.